Knew it. Hey, Lynn. Hope everybody is sitting next to somebody you like to be sitting next to. This is no time to move, you know. Hey, hope you don't mind. We'll kind of start with let me get over here. Whenever you're ready.
Morning. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord? I am.
Hey,
praise the Lord.
Fix the overhead, Matthew. Some of us are quiet. Some of us are loud. All of us are grateful. None of us are proud. We're not what we used to be. We're better off by far. And if you haven't guessed by now, we're gonna tell you who we are. We're peculiar people. We rejoice when things go wrong. We shed tears when we are happy. We sing a glad new thank you. We're the blood of Jesus. We're children of the heavenly King. And if you care to join us, just come along and sing. Now you can see the words. Next time around, you're on. Every day's exciting. It's a new surprise. Miracles still happen, don't they? Right before our eyes. And we don't question where it ends, for we already know that if our King should come today, to heaven we will go. We're peculiar people. We rejoice when things go wrong. We shed tears when we are happy. We sing a glad new song. We're redeemed by the blood of Jesus. We're children of the heavenly King. And if you care to join us, just come along and sing. One more time. We're peculiar people. We rejoice when things go wrong. We shed tears when we are happy. We sing a glad new song. We're redeemed by the blood of Jesus. We're children of the heavenly King. And if you care to join us, just come along and sing. Give yourself a hand, you did great.
It got really quiet.
Welcome to Harvest Chapel. So glad you could be here. It's going to get kind of cooler in Florida here today and tomorrow, but you know what? It's warm in here, and if we have Christ, it's warm in our hearts, and we're so thankful for this. Shall we stand? Dear Lord, as we come to you today, we ask that you will be with each and every one of us, and that we will know your will. What you have for us to do. We pray for this service today, and each person has a part in it, and we'll just give you the praise for everything. Amen. Gary.
All right, joy to the world. Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive. may be seated. You can sing it that way. We'll try it. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to here have ever had a God moment? Probably a lot of you. Some we know about and some we don't know about. But I have one that it was a secular song that God used to protect me from imminent danger. And this happened about 40 years ago. It did happen 40 years ago. And I just got out of work, and it was dark. It was wintertime. There's hardly traffic on the road. And I was on a Route 3A North, heading towards Bow Junction, New Hampshire. And at Bow Junction, I-89 ended at the lights. And so I was on the 3A, and I turned the radio on, and just before I got to Bow Junction, the song by Ray Charles sang it, made it popular, "I Can't Stop Loving You." And for me, you know, there are some secular songs that you can cross over into the gospel realm. There aren't many, but for me, that was one of them. And so I started singing along with Ray Charles, but for me, it was a worship song, and I felt like God was singing to me, "I can't stop loving you," and then I was responding by singing, "I can't stop loving you, Lord." And normally, after work at that time,
Once the light turned green, I was off and running. But for some reason, I was so involved in that song and everything and singing that unbeknownst to me, there was a semi that came barreling through that intersection, a red light. Mm-hmm. And so with just a few seconds, maybe five seconds, whatever, he would have been in my driver's side. And with the type of vehicle that I was driving at the time, 40 years ago, I probably wouldn't be here to tell you about it. So I know about God's protective hand. I've had other times, too, that I knew about, and my family. And those are special times. You never forget them. Amen. We're going to continue singing about his love, such love.
That God should love a sinner such as I, and he should yearn to change my sorrow bliss, no rest till he had planned to bring me nigh. How wonderful is love like this! Such a love, such a wondrous love, such a love, such a wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! And now he takes me to his heart as son. He asks me not to fill a servant's place. The far-off country wanderings all are none. Wide open are his arms of love. Such a love, such a wondrous love, such a love, such a wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! Again, such a love, such a wondrous love, such a wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! All the earth.
stand, for thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth.
Be seated for just a moment. Welcome to Harvest Chapel, all you beautiful, lovely people. It looks so good every Sunday morning that we see these seats are almost full. And that's great. It's great because this is a family reunion, you know, and we just want as many people here as we can get. I think all of you recognize and remember God's phone number, and that's what we're here for this morning, right at this time, is we're going to dial his phone number, and that's Jeremiah 33:3. And he said when we call him, he's going to answer that phone, and then he's going to show us great and mighty things that we just don't know anything about. And I want to tell you right now of one great and mighty thing for sure that he has answered for us. If you'll remember, a week or two ago, we prayed for a friend named Patrick, Bruce and Julie. And he was on a ventilator and things were not looking good. We called on God. And you know what? He has shown us great and mighty things. Patrick has come off of that ventilator, and he's breathing well on his own. And let's give God a big hand for that. I just think it's wonderful. And then our Kathy Keller, she's here today. Hey, hold up your hand, Kathy. We prayed for her last week. She was in the hospital, and don't you know it? She's out of the hospital now, doing well, hallelujah, and she's here with us today. We're just rejoicing daily because God's working in Barry Bloss's life. Remember, we've been praying for him. He's sustaining him through this radiation and chemo that he's taking, and we say amen to that. We also know that today we have with us Bob Parker, who we've been praying for. He's doing really good. It's good to have you, Bob. It's a good thing to see that smiling face back there. And so this good report came this week to Frankie and me for our nephew, Bill Butler, who's in Indiana. You know, we've been praying for him. He's about with cancer, I tell you. That old devil's working double overtime, isn't he? But Bill got a report from the doctor this week that if he didn't increase his eating, get a better appetite, he's going to have a stomach tube put in. Well, the report came just a few days later. He's got an appetite, and he's already beginning to gain a few ounces. So praise God for that. We've been praying for him for a long time. But we do want to continue our prayers for Bill and for Bob Parker and for Bob Wilcox and for Judy Clutter. We pray, we bring that up most every week. And then we had a request that came in. Now, this is a request from a family of a 5-month-old baby who has gone home to be with the Lord, just 5 months old. And so we're praying that God will comfort that family as they walk through this valley. You know that's a hard one to take. So if you would stand with me as I call the elders to come forward. Anyone who cannot stand or you can't come forward or you can't go to the back, we've got an elder in the back. Just hold up your hand where you are, and they're going to do what the Bible says in James chapter 5. It says, call the elders of the church, and they'll anoint you with oil, and the prayer of the faithful will get your prayers answered according to God's plan. So now's the time to come, if you will. The elders are here. They're waiting. Be sure and go to the back if you need to go to the back. Hold up your hand if you can't do either one. Now's the time. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we lift up these requests to you. But first of all, we want to give you a great big thank you from the bottom of our hearts for the prayers that you've answered that have been brought to our attention this week. Lord, we thank you and praise you for all these wonderful things that you do because you said you would. Father, you said when we call on you, you would answer according to your will in our lives, and we receive those answers according to your will. Father, we pray right now for the protection of our military men and women. Father, those who are in active duty, and those who have retired from the military, maybe even in a military hospital. Oh, God, send ministering angels right now to minister to each and every one of them, Father. And if there's some of them there that are very ill and they don't know you as their Lord and Savior, I'm asking you to send laborers into those hospitals or wherever they are, Father, to just give them the word of God and to lead them into the plan of salvation. Father, we just pray for all of those that we come in contact with through the week. Lord, time is so short, and we really need to be looking to our neighbors and friends that we may not even know, but that we cross paths with, Father, to encourage them, Lord Jesus, to come to know you as their Lord and Savior. Father, we thank you for that protection. And now, Father, we feel a very strong unction to be able to pray every week that we can think of it for Jerusalem and for their peace and for all of Israel. Father, they've got an awful lot that they're going to have to go through before this is all over with. And so, Father, we just ask for peace and protection. And Lord, we're going to give you all the honor and the praise and the glory for all of it. In Jesus' name, amen. And you may be seated.
She's playing the right song. Because he lives. Sing it. Because he lives. Now sing it like you mean it. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives. Do you really mean that? You know, you have to sing that several times before it finally gets in your head. You ever have a day when everything went wrong? Yeah. This morning I'm here and trying to get everything set up, and I couldn't get that TV going. I couldn't get the one in the lobby going. I'm trying to fix this and fix that, and everything's falling apart. We get up this morning and start to sing, and nothing comes up on the screen. You know, oh, boy. Years ago, I had a day like that, and I wrote a song that goes like this. Oh, lately, everything has got me thoroughly frustrated. Deep inside, I feel the trouble and I are closely related. But I've been down before, and my God has always lifted me. So don't give up whatever you do. His blessings are coming to you. And the chorus goes, I'm on to something good because everything's been going wrong. I'm on to something good. The devil's been fighting me so long. He always starts his messes just before God blesses. I'm on to something good. The same thing could be happening to you. So don't get discouraged when these things don't work out the way you think they should, because the enemy's trying to stop a blessing coming through for us. Can you say amen? You're in a good mood, aren't you? Good. If you're not, you came to the right place. We had a great concert last Sunday night. The Lester family were here with us, and boy, did they really bless us so much with their music, with their testimony. He even brought the kids up, and those kids sang so beautifully. It was really fantastic. So, and then in a couple weeks, we're going to have the Kramers come. So we like gospel music with words you can understand. Right? It's all about the message, isn't it? Well, we have a lot of people that work behind the scenes, and we want to thank the inside crew for coming and cleaning up everything and keeping it. I keep looking over here. Something went black. Ira is there helping, and Marla and Lorraine and Carol, we appreciate them so much. Outside, we have some people working as well. A lot of things happen behind the scenes preparatory for you getting here and making sure that everything is just right. We had Connie and Lyle, and of course, Sandy working as well. We appreciate them. By the way, if any of you want to consider membership at Harvest Chapel, we want to take you away from any other church you may be a member of, but if you'd like to join Harvest Chapel, see Joyce in the lobby, and she'll tell you, give you a packet about what we are. And also, Matthew Henry, he takes care of our website, lets us know who we are, what we are, and when people are looking for a church. A lot of people come into town, maybe just for a while. We're kind of a transient type of a church, if you know what I'm saying. We get some snowbirds, and we get some people that decide, hey, I'm going to stay here. And so we appreciate that. But they'll tell you all about it on that particular website, harvestchapelofvenice.org. And right now, Lorraine's going to come and tell us whatever else is happening at Harvest Chapel. Come, Lorraine.
Good morning, everybody. So good to see everybody's smiling faces again this week. Well, we have some birthdays coming up. On February 13th.
Mine was last week.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah, we won't mention Pastor Phil's birthday last week, but it was really nice. Yeah, he had a good birthday. Yeah, I'm sure he did. So on February 13th, we have Herb Taylor. On February 14th, wow, a Valentine girl, Marilyn Osborne. And on February 17th, we have Dick Hartung. So happy birthday to all of you. And we also have an anniversary coming up. Oh, it was yesterday. Lyle and Connie Austin, are they here today? Yeah. Oh, there you are. Happy anniversary. How many? 13 years. Wonderful. God is blessing you both very much, yes. Our Share the Word Bible study with Sue Mock will continue again this Wednesday from 3 to 4 o'clock. We're having discussion on the book of Revelation. It's great. You won't want to miss the opportunity to come. Once again, it's at 3 o'clock on Wednesday afternoon, and it's right here. After that study, we have a 30-minute prayer time. We come into the sanctuary, and it's a powerful, refreshing experience. As prayer is taking place in the sanctuary, our prayer warriors are in the prayer room on the right over there, and they're agreeing for special needs. So it's a great opportunity if you have a specific need that you would like to have prayed over. Please join them in that room, and it will be beautiful. You will see results. Our prayer warriors are wonderful. We see good results. All right. Our Sunday school Bible study led by Joan Popio and Trace Vindich will continue every Sunday starting at 9 a.m. Right in the little room out there. As the Word of God is read and discussed, Trace gives a messianic Jewish perspective on the scripture, and it really enlightens us as to the reading of the Bible. We get to understand things in a different way. It's like being there. It's really wonderful. You should try and come at 9 o'clock on Sunday morning. If you have a hunger for the word, please come. We want to thank you for your faithfulness and giving, and pray for God's blessings to be upon each and every one of you. If you're watching via live stream, we have made it possible to give online, and the information is on the overhead, so please make note of that. Our church annual business meeting is tonight at 6 p.m. right here. Everyone is invited, but only members will be voting on issues. So if you're a member of our church, I believe it is, right? Member of the church? Yeah, members of the church can vote on whatever the issues are going to be coming up. This coming Saturday, February 18th, oh boy, the Kramers will be ministering in concert here at Harvest. All of our evening services are held at 6 p.m., so that will be next Saturday at 6 p.m., the Kramers will be here. We love this family, so please bring someone with you to enjoy the presence of the Lord. Next Sunday evening, February 19th, Pastor Phil's nephew, Tim Enlow, and his wife, Rochelle, will be ministering to us. Oh, that'll be nice. They have a unique way of teaching with a special emphasis on the Holy Spirit. You will not want to miss this, and I can't wait. I hope you all have a blessed week, and enjoy your families and friends, and stay safe, and I'll see you next week. God bless.
Good morning. Love is the key word. For those of you that have not done anything yet, you have a day and a half. Scripture this morning comes from 1 John, the 4th chapter, verses 7 through 19. And it begins with this: Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. He loved us first. But he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that he lived in him and he in us. He has given us his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence in the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in God. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
That guy barks it out, doesn't he? Man, thank you so much, Rick. Appreciate that. Hey, are you a list maker? You know, if you're not a list maker, you'll end up forgetting things and what have you. But I keep one by the bed, by the in the car, everywhere to make a list. Because easily I can forget things, like New Year's resolution. Everybody stand, if you will. We're going to repeat it. We started this off in January. We're going to continue now with this Psalm 19:14. It goes like this. Let's all say it together. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Wow. The more you say it, the more you believe it. I said, the more you say it, the more you believe it. I had a couple I was counseling with about marriage, and Jesus said, he never says, I love you anymore. And I said, well, you need to say it more. The first thing of decline in a marriage is you're not saying I love you anymore. It's important to say it. And same with God's word. The more you say it, the more it gets in your heart. Amen. We're going to have a real treat today to have some of our best friends ever to be with us, and that's Larry and Luella Hale. But before I ask Larry to bring the word, but before he does, I ask Lou to come and sing a song. Lou, would you come and sing for us today? This is Luella. We call her Lou.
If I make a list, I forget where I put the list, and so it doesn't do me any good. Go ahead.
Bye.
I met Larry and Luella Hale many, many years ago, before they got married, and had two great friends even before they met one another, and Luella fell in love with Larry, and Larry fell in love with Luella. You knew what I was waiting to see. But they pastor a church in Marysville, Pennsylvania now. They took a church after being on the road for many years in evangelism. They took a church that had been devastated. And by their love and care for people and ministry, it's become a great church. And so we're thrilled to have Larry and Luella. Larry, would you come and share God's word with us today?
Thank you so much. I've got to say, it's going to be tough to leave here on Wednesday. 2 weeks is just not enough time. But I want to thank our Harvest family. You've been such a blessing to us. It's bittersweet because we love our congregation at home, and we miss them, but we're going to miss being here. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14. Would you stand with me as I read from God's word? Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the instruction that you've given us. We thank you that you show us your love through your word. And I pray today your word will permeate our hearts, that we will not only hear your word, but we will retain your word, that we will use your word daily to live for you, and that we will teach others what your word has to say. Lord, have your way. In Christ's precious name, amen. You may be seated. You know, it was good to hear you all recite your congregational resolution. It's good to do that weekly because you won't forget it. Now, this year I made a couple of resolutions also, and though I don't repeat them weekly, I don't think I'll forget them. As a matter of fact, I think I'll get through this year and not break those resolutions. In fact, they may just keep going on because I've resolved to eat more and exercise less. This morning, I want to present to you four challenges for the new year that will make a radical difference in your life if you choose to accept them. That sounds like it's from Mission Impossible, doesn't it? These will not self-destruct. Actually, they will be good for you if you choose to do it. Those four challenges are to forget your failures, to give up the grudges that you hold in your life, to restore broken relationships, and to turn your back on past transgressions. Looking at the first one, the Apostle Paul, writing to the church in Philippi, says, once again, brothers and sisters, I have not considered myself to have arrived yet. I've not arrived. I'm not where I should be. But the one thing I do is forget what is behind, forget my failures, and I strain towards what is ahead. That word strain makes me think that it's not easy to do what he's asking us to do. But by the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, we can strain towards that which God has called us heavenward for. That wonderful prize, that wonderful reward that he has for us. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So here we see the Apostle Paul, one of the most prolific writers of the New Testament, the apostle of apostles, church planter extraordinaire. He's confessing to the church that he has not yet arrived. So what he's saying is, I'm not perfect. Well, duh. There has never been a perfect person on this earth except Christ, and there will never be another perfect person on this side of heaven. We are all broken vessels. Every one of us sins and falls short of the glory of God. So my challenge to you is to just understand this. Forget your failures. Focus on that prize that is ahead of you. And I would encourage us all not to think too highly of ourselves, and also not to think too lowly of ourselves. One of the things that I encourage people to do is not compare themselves to other people. And certainly don't expect other people to be perfect, because you're not. Neither am I. So let go of your past and plot a course to the future. We all fail. We all fall short of the glory of God. The thing is, we're just big old balls of flesh. And flesh fails. We make bad decisions, so we should admit our failures and move on. You see, you may have failed, but that does not make you a failure. Failing or failures are what you did. It is not who you are. Paul didn't get bogged down because of his past. And he had a sordid past. He was known for persecuting Christians, persecuting the followers of the way of Jesus. He was there at the stoning of Stephen, and he even approved the stoning of Stephen. He threw Christians into prison. But when he encountered Jesus, he was transformed. He became a new creation. And therefore, he could humbly admit his failure. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, he could also look forward to doing better in the future. Saul became Paul when he encountered Jesus. He quickly learned to live and love as Jesus does. Because Paul loved the Lord, Paul did his part. But then he trusted God for the rest. And that's where we need to be. We need to love the Lord so much that we desire in our hearts to let go and let God control our lives, to look forward to him working in our lives in the future, to bring us into the men and women that we should be, men and women of faith. We need to ask him to bring beauty from the ashes of our lives. I too had a very sordid story. We were talking about this the other day. In 2005, my testimony was released worldwide in 8 different languages. I was not a nice fellow. I failed a lot. I failed my family. I failed my friends. But I am a new creation in Christ. And I am pressing on towards that mark for the glory of God, not for the glory of Larry. Jesus is the way maker. He can and will make a way for you to be free of the chains of your past failures. And he is right here now. He is in this place. You can sense the presence of the Holy Spirit when you walk in here, right? Can you feel his presence right now? He is here to recreate you. He is here to forgive you. He is here to guide you. And he is here to teach you how to live and love like him. If we will permit him to do that, God is a perfect gentleman. He will never force us to do anything. He gives us the opportunity He gives us the tools. He equips us for everything we need for life on earth and eternal life. So we need to forgive ourselves and start fresh, pressing on towards a prize. That's worth rejoicing over. That's good news. Because when we do that, when we come to him and ask him to forgive us of our failures, he forgives us and he casts our sins as far as the east is from the west, never to be seen again. I've heard it said that he cannot see past the blood of Jesus. And I think this is probably the most important thing, is to recognize that your story is not over. Regardless of how old or how young you are, those of you watching online, those of you sitting here today, your story is not over. You see that semicolon? It continues on from there. I saw this quote from Holly Girth at Fierce Hearted. Some of you ladies may know of her. She said, "Let's remember we are all still in the beauty, in the middle of the messy, beautiful work of becoming. We are a masterpiece in progress." Progress, to quote a friend of mine. Sometimes I feel like I'm a masterpiece in progress. But we are all his. And when we give ourselves to him, he can make us into the men and women he wants us to be. So we need to forget our failures. We also need to let go of our grudges. Excuse me. Colossians 3:13 says, "Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you." That's saying that we need to make allowance for others' faults. We need to forgive anyone who offends us. And I'm going to stop right now and make a point. Any and every offense that has ever occurred in your life and will occur in your life is straight from the pit of hell. That is not God, folks. When we receive an offense, we're letting the enemy control our lives. So we need to remember that the Lord forgave us, and we need to forgive others who have hurt us. We need to, well, Jesus himself said it. If we cannot forgive, he cannot forgive us. That's important that we understand that. So quit holding on to grudges. Bear with one another. Simply choose not to argue and fuss when other people do not share your opinions. Love each other enough to respect our beliefs, our doctrinal positions. Oh, Lord, help me. Our political positions. Let us love as Christ loves us, respecting each other and respecting the uniqueness that God has given each of us. We are a peculiar people. Some of us more peculiar than others. So God's word challenges us to let go of ongoing resentment. And you know, that's good for the person who perhaps has offended you, that you let go of it. But it's better for you than even than it is for them. Because holding on to grudges are dangerous and can be destructive. Grudges destroy marriages, they break up families, they ruin friendships, and they split churches. If you're holding on to a grudge today, God says, drop it, let it go, and don't pick it up again. It's critical that we understand that, once again, all offenses, all grudges, all hurts, all jealousy, they are straight from the pit of hell. Grudges are destructive and self-destructive because most of the time they hurt us more than they hurt the person we're holding a grudge against. Harboring a grudge will eventually destroy us. If not physically, it can destroy us emotionally. It can destroy us spiritually. People who harbor grudges become bitter and twisted. In Job chapter 2, it describes people who have no happiness at all. They live and they die with bitter hearts. Is that the way you want to be remembered? Not me. Max Lucado makes this interesting comment in one of his books. He says, unforgiving servants always end up in prison. Prisons of anger, guilt, and depression. Then he says simply, don't sentence yourself to prison. God, in his word, is saying to us, don't sentence yourself to prison. He wants us to live as free men and women. If you're from Pennsylvania, you'll understand that remark. Let's choose to give up our grudges, forgive each other, and bear with each other in love. God's word is so cool. It is so awesome. We're going to go to the third challenge here, and that is to commit yourself to restore broken relationships. In Romans chapter 12, verse 18, it says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live peaceably with a couple of men. Some men, I'm sorry. Oh, no, that says everyone, doesn't it? As much as it depends on you, God challenges you to live at peace with everyone, even those you disagree with, even those that have piercings and tattoos and smell like, well, I don't even want to discuss that smell. Even those who disagree with your political position, I'll say that again. Because as Christians, we're supposed to be known by our love. That doesn't mean we condone what other people have done. But it does mean that if Christ loves them with an everlasting love, and if nothing can separate them from the love of God, then nothing should separate them from our love. That we should do everything we can to have a good relationship, especially with those who are unbelievers. Because the greatest witness we have is the way we live our lives before them. I have encountered people in my life that I had literally I just didn't want to be around them at all. But because of circumstances, I was. And I remember one person in particular. I had been given his position where I worked, and he was demoted. He wasn't very happy with me, and he really got on my nerves. And finally, the Lord said to me, just love him. Pray for him. And I began to pray for him. I left that place. Years later, I received a phone call from that man. Now, that man, when we were on the road, cheated on his wife. He would get drunk. I mean, he was foul. And the day he called me on the phone, I went, oh, Lord, why? But he called to invite me to a Bible study. God got a hold of his life. He wanted to make amends. That is the position all of our hearts should be in. To want to make amends. God wants us to be proactive in restoring broken relationships. Now, Glenvale Church of God, where I'm the pastor, we will be starting our 19th year on March 1st. And there are still people in that congregation whom I love, but they just don't get it. They're still at odds with members of their families. They are not doing what they need to do. They're holding on to those grudges, and therefore their lives are a mess. Sometimes we just need to say, Lord, I can't do it. Please do it for me. Luella testifies to the murder of her brother. She had a 25-year-old brother that was murdered by a teenage acquaintance of his. And after his murder, Luella said, I couldn't forgive. I tried. I kept going back to the Lord and asking him to help me to forgive that young man. She said, finally, one day she was just imagining herself beating on God's chest and saying, I can't forgive, I can't forgive. And then she heard a still small voice that said, if you can't forgive him, then I can't forgive you. Those simple words, I forgive you, or perhaps, I'm sorry, would you forgive me, go a long way. This is still very early in the new year. What a great time to make your relationships right with others. And here's the thing, if you go back to someone who has wronged you and they will not receive your apology or your forgiveness, you've done what the Word of God tells you to do. You have made the effort. You can live with a pure heart and let God handle the rest. Maybe God is saying to you right now, you need to restore a relationship by going and sincerely saying that you are sorry for whatever caused that relationship. And I make no mistake about it, it's going to be hard. But if you do it, you will be rewarded. And not just in heaven. Your heart will be lifted. You'll be able to concentrate more and worship him better. Because you don't have that wall between you. It is a wall. So I ask you, will you make the challenge to rise up and restore your broken relationships in this new year? Commit to forget your failures, give up your grudges, restore your relationships, and lastly, turn your backs on your transgressions. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts. After the American Civil War was over and the slaves were freed, many of them went back to their masters. They decided to stay with their former master and continue to do what they were told. Many lives were sacrificed to set them free. But yet they chose to go back and serve their old master. And according to the New Testament, that is what many Christians do. Christ died to set us free. The Holy Spirit has given us the power to live free. But just like those former slaves, many Christians choose to obey their old master. Sin in their lives. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies. That's a command from God. Do not let sin control the way you live. Don't give up to your sin, or don't give in to your sinful desires. He's challenging us to turn our backs on our old master. We are new creations, aren't we? He is the Lord of our lives, right? Then he is our master. He is the one that we should live in submission to. He is the one that we should yield ourselves to. Don't let the same old sin overcome you. Scripture talks about besetting sins. And when there are besetting sins in your lives, those sins that you just can't seem to overcome, or you're so comfortable with them, you live with them. You end up trying to hide your sins and end up living a double life. I just told Pastor Phil yesterday, I got an email from our conference office this week. A George Barna survey shows that 54% of all pastors are actively or have been involved in pornography. 67% of youth pastors. They're living double lives. If they're still in that sin. Don't be like the man who has that huge growth on his neck. He wouldn't do anything about it. He just learned to live with that huge growth on his neck. Too many of us try to hide our sins, or we try to ignore our sins, or we sweep them under the rug. We simply learn to live with the sin in our lives. Now, you know that's not going to turn out well, right? We have to confess our sins. And when we confess our sins, he is faithful, he is just, he will forgive us of our sins. He will cleanse us of that unrighteousness. And the Holy Spirit, when we yield to him, will empower us to overcome, to have victory over that sin in our lives. Some of you watching today may be in that position. You're struggling with sin. You want out of that sin. You're not able to get in that sin because you're not fully committed to giving it to the Lord. That slave who was under the control of a master had to do what that master said. Our God is gracious. He doesn't make us do it. But we also need to understand that we reap what we sow. That is a biblical concept. Excuse me, when we try to sweep our sins under the rug, or we're not willing to give them totally to the Lord, we end up settling for a form of godliness with no power. Maybe your spiritual life is crippled because you've learned to live with a besetting sin. Maybe you have a quick temper, or you constantly give in to a tongue that assassinates, one that wounds the feelings of others. Maybe you have a critical spirit that you've learned to live with, a judgmental attitude that you know is wrong. Well, God's challenge to us today is to turn our backs on that besetting sin, to stop letting them control us, to stop obeying our old master. And I want to be perfectly clear about this. The death of Jesus broke the power of sin. And if the Holy Spirit is in you, he is willing and able to give you the power that you need to be victorious. The good news is, if we choose to permit him, the Holy Spirit will change us. And we will not have to end 2023 by the same old sin, defeated by the same old sin. God says we are no longer slaves to sin, and we should not live like one or act like a slave. Please don't miss this opportunity for a better life. It all boils down to this. Will 2023 just be another calendar year in your life? Or will it be a new era in your spiritual life? I've challenged you with four challenges this morning. To forget your failures. You may have failed, but you are not a failure. Let go of it, because failures will hold you back. We don't live too far from Hershey, Pennsylvania, and I've read the story of Milton Hershey and how many times he failed in business before he succeeded. Or Edison in the number of attempts to make a light bulb. We're not a failure just because we failed something. God's plan for you is to prosper you, to give you a hope in the future. You're the only one that can hold yourself back. Give up those grudges. You will be defeated by those grudges if you don't give them up. It's God's will that you have a pure heart. I think of King David in Psalm 51 when he went to the Lord and he cried out from the depth of his sin because he realized that he needed to be made whole and holy again. It's God's desire that we are all holy, and he makes us righteous. This is difficult, but you can do it. Work on restoring those broken relationships as best you can. Live at peace with everybody, including your family, who knows you better than anybody else. And turn your back on your past sins. You are a new creation. Don't serve an old master. Serve him. So I challenge you today to have the courage here today to forgive yourself and to put away the past, to forgive those who have hurt you. As far as it depends on you, live at peace with them, and to ask God's forgiveness. You are no longer a slave to sin. Would you like to be an overcomer this day? Then give it all to Jesus. Gosh, that would be a great song, wouldn't it? Let's pray. My Lord and my God, we are all just jars of clay. You created man from the dust of the earth, and these tents that we live in one day will go back to dust. In the meantime, according to Psalm 139, you have made each and every one of us to be the unique individuals that we are, and that you have planned every one of our days before we were even born. Every one of our days was written in your book of life. Every one of our days was written in your book, not the book of life. You have a plan, a perfect plan for each and every one of us. And though we all stray from that plan, you stand there like the father of a prodigal son, waiting for us to return, waiting for us to come to ourselves, waiting for us to realize that we are not receiving all that we should have in Christ Jesus. And it's not because you are withholding anything from us. It's because we are withholding ourselves from you. May this be the day that we let go and let God. May this be the day that we confess our sins and be free eternally. And may we press on towards the mark, looking forward to hearing those words one day. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Father God, I pray your will and your way in the life of each person here today and each person watching today. Recreate us to be the men and women of God that you want us to be, and let us follow you all the days of our lives. I pray this in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Thank you all.
Let's sing that. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Will you stand with me, please? There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. And earth proclaimed. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, all but there's something. We talked about list makers. This is a good list to follow up. We've got a brand new year to make some brand new changes. And we're challenged by God's word to do this. And we will. Can you say amen? Lord, thank you for this word, for this challenge, for the brand new year given to us. Help us make some changes, I pray. And Lord, let the world see the difference in us as we go about our business in the world. Let the light of Christ shine through our life that others can see Christ in us. In Jesus' name we pray, dismiss us now. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful day.